So good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for joining in for the 18th webinar of OnQuest Laboratories. We are happy to bring forth to you these series of educational webinars, and we're really glad that people across India and several parts of Asia are logging in. We hope to continue this with your support. Thank you so much for joining in, and as you all know, OnQuest is an NABL and CAP accredited laboratory. We have a presence across India and also parts of Asia with a network of 43 laboratories and about 350 collection centers. So in today's series, we will be talking about myeloproliferative neoplasms. So myeloproliferative neoplasm belongs to the category of chronic hematological malignancies. And the discovery of this goes back to about 1951 when the hematologist William Damczyk, in his editorial for the Blood magazine, described them as myeloproliferative disorders. And it was not known then whether it was malignant or non-malignant, whether it was primary by itself or it was secondary to something else. So over the years, tremendous progress has been made in the understanding of the molecular and genetic basis of this disease, due to which the disease, it was renamed in 2008 as myeloproliferative neoplasm. And there are several milestones in the progress of this disease, not only in the discovery of molecular basis of this disease, but also in targeted therapy. And since it is such a vast topic and we always encounter difficulties while coming to a conclusion as to which of the myeloproliferative neoplasms we are dealing with, we have divided the topic into two parts. So the first part will cover all the BCR-ABL dependent myeloproliferative neoplasms, including CML and some other related entities like chronic eosinophilic leukemia, chronic neutrophilic leukemia. And we will also touch upon atypical CML. In the second part, we will be talking about the BCR-ABL negative myeloproliferative neoplasms. So for this difficult topic, we have none other than Dr. Tejinder Singh. He was formerly professor and HOD at Maulana Azad Medical College and has joined OnQuest more than 3 years ago as a senior consultant and in charge of the bone marrow division of hematopathology at OnQuest Laboratories. And he, as you all know, has more than 42 years of experience in teaching, in publishing papers, and he basically doesn't need too many introduction. All of us know him very well. We have read his textbooks before writing our MD examination. He has held positions in Indian Association of Pathology and Microbiology. He's been the past president of ISHBT and also the joint secretary of IAP. So let's, I hand over the stage to Dr. Tejinder Singh, who will today talk about the first part of myeloproliferative neoplasm. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pia. Thank you, Dr. Pia. Now, as and welcome to this webinar. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Pia, and welcome to all the participants. Today we'll be covering myeloproliferative neoplasms. As you all know, that these are clonal population of rare cells within the bone marrow, which undergo MPN initiating somatic mutation, and that results in self-renewal. Not only self-renewal, but indefinite self-renewal. They keep on proliferating, as a result of which there is a clonal expansion of the cells. and they arrive from the hematopoietic stem cell compartment. And these are the somatic mutations which affect the hematopoietic stem cell, and the result is a myeloproliferative neoplasm. Now, these are slightly different from other proliferative disorders of the hematology. Here we find that there is an effective hematopoietic proliferation. That is one. That means the cells produce mature cells like red cells, like platelets, like white cells. So there is an effective hematopoietic proliferation. And we find there is organomegaly. Usually spleen is involved. Liver may also be involved. Then there are elevated peripheral blood counts because there is an effective hematopoietic proliferation. So as a result, either the white cells or the red cells or the platelets, they increase. In all of them, fibrosis of a variable degree may occur. Now, how do we classify them? Depending upon the dominant cell line which is involved. See, for example, if the red cells are involved, then we label it as polycythemia vera. When platelets are involved, we label it as essential thrombocythemia. And if the white cells are involved, we label it as chronic myeloid leukemia. In all of them, there is a hepatosplenomegaly of a variable degree, maximum being in primary myelofibrosis, followed by CML. There is hypercatabolism, and there is a clonal marrow hyperplasia. As you can see here, the stem cells, myeloid stem cells, they may lead to proliferation of the white cells. Then we have CML. If it is the platelets are formed, then ET. If the red cells are formed, it is polycythemia vera. Now, the 2017 classification of WHO has classified as 7 entities, and these are CML, chronic neutrophilic leukemia, chronic eosinophilic leukemia, MPN, unclassifiable. And then we have 3 disorders, which are JAK2, KRAS, and MPN mutation related. Now, these are the ones, the CML, of course, is BCR-ABL. Now, these 3 entities are BCR-ABL negative proliferative disorders, which are PV, ET, and primary myelofibrosis. When this classification came, 2017 classification, the blue book came, in 2015, there was an article by the same workers, that is Barboy, Thiel, Panucci, and Tiferi, and where they gave that why they are revising the WHO diagnostic criteria for these 3 myeloproliferative neoplasms. And they said that the idea is that there should be a standard bone marrow morphology, including that of bone marrow trephine biopsy, which was not there in 2008. There should be an accurate reticulin fibril grading. And then there should be correlated with the clinical findings. And finally, we have to incorporate the new markers which had come. In 2008, we had JAK2 and MPL, but KLR was not there. KLR was discovered sometime in 2012. And then its role was seen over the next 3 years. So in 2015, this article came. And then they said that there are about 10 to 15% of the cases of myeloproliferative, which are unclassifiable. Now the same workers, after the classification was propounded, they have reviewed the WHO classification, and then they have seen that how far it is applicable in clinical practice while looking at the bone marrow trephines, bone marrow aspirates, correlating with the clinical findings, and along with the various molecular markers, that is JAK2, KLR, MPL, etc. Now the saga of imatinib began in 2000 to 2001. That was a year when it was discovered that the BCR-ABL is the characteristic feature of CML. Once it was known that the Philadelphia chromosome, which we knew earlier in 1970s and 80s, it is a BCR-ABL change or the molecular change which occurs, and this mutation results in proliferation of the CML. And this mutation results in tyrosine kinase secretion. So what was needed was an inhibitor. So the tyrosine kinase inhibitor, and what we nowadays call as TKI, this research was in mid-90s, was carried out, and imatinib was established as an anti-BCR-ABL drug. And that is how the era of target therapy in malignancies began. And this was the first target therapy, and there was a cover on Time magazine where they said that these are the bullets, or this is the ammunition of TKI inhibitor. And at that time, this was Gleevec. And now we know that actually the generic drug is imatinib. Now we have various methods of assessing the TK and the BCR-ABL. And then we can also do quantitative BCR-ABL pre-therapy and then intratherapy. This WHO classification, while classifying the MPNs, they said that there are some non-classic MPNs which consisted of CEL, chronic eosinophilic leukemia, CNL, MPN unclassified. The mast cell disorders which were included in the 2008 classification were taken off. Then they said the classic ones. They said there are four classic ones. Those are BCR-ABL positive, that is only one, CML, and the BCR-ABL negative are the polycythemia vera, essential thrombocythemia, and primary myelofibrosis, where the morphology plays a great role. And these are the three diagnoses which we will be covering in the next lecture. Now, what happens is that these precursor cells, it all depends that which molecule or the which mutation is responsible. If we find that the committed precursor cells, there is a stimulation by the mutation which results on EPO, that means there is a production, increased production of the red cells. If it is GM-CSFR, then it is the monocytes which increase. And if it is GCSFR receptor, then it is the neutrophils. And if it is MPL, or the receptor for the platelets, which acts on the megakaryocytes, and the platelets are formed, and their production results in the disease that is the myeloproliferative neoplasm. So, what is necessary for the myeloproliferative neoplasm are two things. One is a stem cell, multipotent stem cell, which has got a mutation, and that mutation we label it as driver mutation, and that is the one which is responsible for the proliferation of white cells, red cells, or WBCs. Now, which are the driver mutations? These are three important ones: JAK2, MPL, CALR. Then there are 10% cases which are triple negative. That means none of them is positive in few of the myeloproliferative neoplasms. Now, these driver mutations, they differ in clinical phenotype. Now, which mutation which lead to which disease? Say, for example, JAK2 can lead to polycythemia. JAK2 can lead to essential thrombocythemia. JAK2 can also lead to primary myelofibrosis. Now, what will happen if the mutational burden is less or high, if there is a co-occurring mutations, that will determine that which disease a person is going to get. Second thing is that all these mutations, they result in cytokine signaling, and that cytokine signaling results in proliferation of the cells. Another thing is that these driver mutations are very closely associated with survival. The average survival for CALR is 17 years, for JAK2 and MPL it is 9 years, and for triple negative, the prognosis is the worst. It is about 3 years only. Now, JAK2 mutations, what we usually say JAK2 is actually the exon 14, which is seen in 95% of the polycythemia vera patients. And of course, in 50 to 60% of ET and PMF, while the JAK2 exon is seen in about 3% of the polycythemia vera patients. Now, MPL mutation is uncommon, and it occurs in 5 to 8% of the patients. And actually it acts directly on the TPO receptor or the thrombopoietin, which results in proliferation of the platelets. Now, CALR or the CAL reticulin mutations are proliferative and they activate the JAK-STAT pathway signaling, and that results in proliferation of the cells. And then finally, we have the triple negative mutations, and it is seen that these are the cases which have the worst prognosis. And it is because of the fact that the blast transformation in triple negative cases occurs early, and that is why the prognosis is bad in these cases. Now, before we go on to CML and others, a word about the megakaryopoiesis. We all know that it is from the megakaryoblast. Then there is a promegakaryocyte, and then we find that the promegakaryocyte, the cytoplasm becomes granular, pinkish granules appear. And then finally, we have a mature megakaryocyte where the nuclear lobulation starts, the cytoplasm becomes pink and granular. And that is a diagrammatic representation starting from a megakaryoblast to endomitotic synchronous division from 2 to 4 to 8 and so on. It keeps on increasing in cases of megakaryopoiesis, and then gradually the cytoplasmic granulation appears, and once it is a mature megakaryocyte, you find that the platelets are formed. Now, this is a megakaryocyte where you find that the budding of the platelets takes place from the cytoplasm. Now, this is under the influence of thrombopoietin, GATA1, FOG1, and FLY1. And the cytoplasm, as it becomes granular, only then you find that the platelets are formed. And finally, once the platelets are formed, the cytoplasm diminishes. The nucleus only is seen, what we call as bare nuclei. And then we find that those bare nuclei, they become senescent. Now, whenever we talk of megakaryocytes, because these play a great role in classifying the myeloproliferative neoplasms on the basis of morphology. So we must know what are normal megakaryocytes, what are dwarf megakaryocytes, what are giant megakaryocytes, what are dysplastic megakaryocytes, and megakaryocytes with bulbous or cloud-like nuclei. Now this is, you find megakaryocytic hyperplasia in cases of normal or ITP cases where the morphology is normal. Now this is to show you normal megakaryocytes with lobulated nuclei, and what you find on the bone marrow trephine biopsy, the megakaryocytes show us lobulated nuclei. The size is normal. This is the normal size of megakaryocytes. Here we find that the megakaryocytes are proliferating, but what we find, these megakaryocytes are small, and these are known as dwarf megakaryocytes. The nuclear characteristic feature is that these are hypolobated nuclei of these megakaryocytes. Now, the same thing in a bone marrow trephine biopsy, where we find that the megakaryocytes are small, dwarf, and they have hypolobated nuclei. Now, these are the ones we come across in cases of chronic myeloid leukemia. Now, chronic myeloid leukemia, we find that T922 or the BCR-ABL oncoprotein is formed, and it has got three phases: chronic phase, accelerated phase, and finally these cases may go on to a blastic phase. The characteristic feature which results in proliferation of the cells is a T922 translocation. Here we find that the arrow is pointing towards chromosome 9. This arrow is pointing towards chromosome 22, and there is a reciprocal translocation between the two, and there used to be the formation of what we used to call it earlier as Philadelphia chromosome. What we find here is, this is chromosome 9, this is chromosome, the pink one is 22, the ABL part is in chromosome 9, and the BCR part, the green one, is in chromosome 22. Now there is a reciprocal translocation. So what we find is that this part of the chromosome of 22 that comes to chromosome 9, and you find that the chromosome 9 has become longer than the original chromosome 9. That is one. Second thing, what we find is the ABL part of the chromosome from chromosome 9 has gone on to 22. Now, as it goes on to 22, the BCR is already there. So there is synthesis or there is formation of BCR-ABL. Now, that is what you can see. The ABL is the red part, as you can see here. Green is the BCR part. And then this shifts and then combines. There is formation of BCR-ABL. And that leads to synthesis of BCR-ABL protein. Now, there are multiple breakpoints in BCR-ABL. So we come across BCR-ABL P210, or we come across P190, or we come across P230. Of these, P210 is the commonest, followed by P190. And in very few cases, we find P230 is present. Now, most of the cases of BCR-ABL positive ALL, which is a new entity which has come in 2017 classification, we find that it is not the P210, but in majority of them, it is P190. And some cases have a poorer outcome. Now, clinical presentation of CML is that for 30% cases are asymptomatic. There could be fever, weight loss, fatigue. Main characteristic clinical feature is splenomegaly. And because of the splenomegaly, patients complains of abdominal fullness, there is pain or early satiety. There could be easy bruising and purpura. There could be some pulmonary or neurologic symptoms because of the leukostasis. And then this is the blood picture. So first of all, what is the blood picture? Number one, TLC. The TLC goes up. Anything from 1 lakh to 5 lakhs, that is the usual count, but it could be less, it could be more. On differential count, what do we find? We find that there are immature white cells which are present in the peripheral smear. TLC is high. What you find are the mature neutrophils, you find metamyelocytes, then you find there are myelocytes, and rather the myelocytes are more. What we label these cases as myelocyte bulge. And then we find there are basophils which are present. So this is one condition where we find there is basophilia. There is few nucleated RBCs are also present. This is also basophil. So there is basophilia, there is eosinophilia. And then we find the red cells are usually normocytic, normochromic. Platelets in this field, you are finding only 4 of them, but usually there is thrombocytosis. Platelets are increased in these cases. TLC may go very high, and the blast cells are not markedly increased. Blast cells are usually 1 to 5%. Here you can see one blast cell in this particular field. Here you find there is eosinophil is present, eosinophilic precursors. This is another eosinophilic precursors. So there is eosinophilia, there is basophilia, myelocyte bulge. Here you find 1, 2 eosinophilic myelocytes are present. Earlier, when we didn't have BCR-ABL, either we used to go for Philadelphia chromosome demonstration, and then the NAP score or the neutrophil alkaline phosphatase score was carried out. This is carried out on this peripheral smear of a case of CML. And you find that the neutrophils, by and large, are negative. There is only one neutrophil here in the lower part, which is grade 2 positive. So we used to count 100 neutrophils and multiply them with a score, which used to be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the total score normal was 40 to 100. But in CML, it used to be less than 40%. Even now, whenever we do NAP score, it is less than 40%. Usually it is between 0 to 20. Going on to the bone marrow, we find that the bone marrow aspirate, when we do, we find the fragments are markedly hypercellular. The cellularity is about 100%, 90% to 100%, markedly cellular. And which proliferative cell line? Here we find that it is the granulocytic proliferative line, which is very, very hyperplastic. Now that is again reflected in the bone marrow aspirate smear. We are again finding that the erythroid precursors are markedly diminished. In this field, we don't find any erythroid precursor. All of them are myeloid precursors. And then we find there is a blast cell, there are promyelocytes, and then you find myelocytes, metamyelocytes, and then again you come across basophils. So basophilia is a feature which is seen in the peripheral blood. It is seen in bone marrow, and we find the myelocyte bulge. Now, this is to show you what we come across on fish. That is, there is a BCR, ABL, and the yellow one is a combination of the two. So this is BCR, ABL positive. Now, what happens to other cell lines? This is the myeloid cell line. We've come across very, very few erythroid precursors are present. So the ME ratio is usually very, very high. Anything from 20:1 to 97:98:1. And then we come across these megakaryocytes. The megakaryocytes are either normal in number, as in this particular case, or there is a biproliferative lines, that is myeloid proliferation as well as megakaryocytic proliferation. Now, this is CML, in which we find there are a few megakaryocytes, but mainly it is a granulocytic proliferation. And whenever there is a late phase, then it's not only granulocytic proliferation, but the megakaryocytic proliferation also starts. Initially in 80s and 90s, Bartel and his group from Germany, they said that there are two types of CMLs, CML in which there is a granulocytic proliferation, and the CML in which there is a granulocytic and megakaryocytic proliferation. Then he said that these are the cases which go on to myelofibrosis at a later date, while the granulocytic proliferation cases go on to blastic phase early. But now it has been proved that granulocytic proliferation is the earlier stage, and the granulocytic plus megakaryocytic proliferation is the late phase of the same disease process. So whenever we come across both granulocytic and megakaryocytic proliferation, we should think on the line that this is a late phase of CML. This is what the late phase of the CML is, where you find granulocytic proliferation, and you are also coming across megakaryocytic proliferation. And then you find that many megakaryocytes are hypolobated. You don't find multiple lobes of these megakaryocytic nuclei. Only hypolobated lobes are seen in these megakaryocytes. Then we also come across C-blue histiocytes, acquired C-blue histiocytes, where you find the C-blue granules are seen. And here you find a pseudo-Gaucher cell, which is seen. Now, these cells are present because of the rapid turnover in chronic myeloid leukemia, like in thalassemia major or even in ITP. Now, this is the picture on bone marrow biopsy. We find when there is a mainly granulocytic proliferation, or so to say, early phase of granulocytic of CML. And here we find there are these dwarf megakaryocytes. These are smaller in size, and they have hypolobated nuclei. Advanced phase, here we find there is a granulocytic proliferation, and there is also a megakaryocytic proliferation. Then here you come across three bare nuclei, and then you find these are the megakaryocytes. These are normal size megakaryocytes, but then there are hypolobated megakaryocytes also, and that is a characteristic feature of CML. However, when we talk of ET, we find giant megakaryocytes, which will be shown to you in the next lecture. Now, this advanced phase, or whenever we come across granulocytic and the megakaryocytic proliferation, there is reticulin laying down. Because of the increased reticulin laying down, you find that there is streaming of the cells. And this streaming of the cells indicates that the reticulin is increased. With passage of time, we find that not only the reticulin increases, but in later stages, as you can see here, there is laying down of collagen. And you find there is a tremendous megakaryocytic proliferation throughout the marrow. There is granulocytic proliferation. There is increased reticulin, and there is marrow fibrosis. So the just presence of marrow fibrosis does not mean that we are dealing with a case of primary myelofibrosis. We should be aware of the fact that in later stages of CML, we do come across increased reticulin, and we also come across collagenization, megakaryocytic proliferation, and few dysplastic megakaryocytes as well. This is to show you the increased reticulin fibrils, which you are seeing in a bone marrow trephine biopsy in a CML advanced phase. And this is to show you again that the megakaryocytic proliferation is so much that it appears as if this is a disease of the megakaryocytes and not of the myeloid series. Actually, again, it is a case of CML advanced phase with both granulocytic and megakaryocytic proliferation. Now, how do we diagnose? See, we know that the peripheral smear is diagnostic in a way with basophilia and eosinophilia. Similar is the bone marrow aspirate and trephine biopsy. However, still we have to demonstrate the most characteristic finding, that is the BCR-ABL. So how do we demonstrate that? One of the methods of demonstration is FISH. By FISH diagnosis, we can demonstrate that this is ABL red is of chromosome 9, BCR green at chromosome 22, and then the BCR-ABL fusion occurs. In addition, there is a yellow dot. So this triple dot of yellow color, green color, and the pink color indicates that the BCR-ABL is present in this case of CML. And what are the other molecular tests we can carry on are that now we have quantitative real-time PCR method. Now this real-time PCR method, we can do a quantitative assay of BCR-ABL, that how many transcripts are present. So what we do is when the patient comes before starting the therapy, we take the fusion transcript level, which is pre-therapy. And as we give the therapy, then every 3 months, we not only assess qualitatively that BCR-ABL is present or not, but we also do a quantitative assay, which tells us whether the patient is responding to therapy or not. Now we know that if the patient is not responding to therapy, his BCR-ABL is not decreasing, then we can go on to the fact that the BCR-ABL mutations, there is resistance to it. Now that means this patient is resistant to imatinib. Then we go on to second and third line of drugs, which are dasatinib and nilotinib. So we go, instead of giving imatinib, we may change over to dasatinib or nilotinib. Then as the time passes, now we know that these cases of CML, they may get cured. The number of these transcripts of BCR-ABL diminish. However, some of the cases, they still go on to accelerated phase. When we were students at that point of time, the general course was we used to give Myleran. Later on, it was changed to hydroxyurea. So the patient of a chronic phase will go on to accelerated phase, and then accelerated phase would go on to a blast crisis in a case of CML. Now, what are the criteria for accelerated phase of CML is increasing WBCs. That is, if it is more than 1 lakh and unresponsive to therapy. Second is persistent or increasing splenomegaly, again, unresponsive to therapy. Thrombocytosis more than 10 lakhs, unresponsive. Persistent thrombocytopenia, that is less than 100,000, unrelated to therapy. If even the basophils are more than 20%, that indicates that the patient is in late phase or accelerated phase. And most important thing is increase in blast cells. If the blast cells increase from 1 to 5% to 10 to 19%, we say either in the peripheral blood or in the bone marrow, usually it is in both, we say that the patient has gone on to accelerated phase. And if we do the chromosomal analysis and we find that additional chromosomal abnormalities appear in these cases. Now, this can be assessed in a different way. The clinician goes by the fact that the response to TKI is not coming up. The patient has developed a hematologic resistance. Only then we think on the lines that the patient might have gone into accelerated phase. So what we find on in these cases on the bone marrow is that large clusters or sheets of abnormal megakaryocytes, as we can see, with marked reticulin increase, which you can see that the reticulin is increased, not only reticulin, but there is a collagen fibrosis also, it should be considered as presumptive evidence of accelerated phase as per WHO. And of course, we find that these findings of abnormal megakaryocytes clustering of megakaryocytes, increased fibrosis. These are associated with accelerated phase, or what we used to, now we call it as advanced phase of CML. Now, this is the peripheral smear and bone marrow. Accelerated phase, here you can see the blast cells are increased. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So here you find that the blast cells are increased in the peripheral blood. This is the bone marrow. And what we find in the bone marrow or in the peripheral blood, that this is a basophil, this is a basophil. The basophils are increased. Not only that, even the blast cells, 1, 2, 3 blast cells are also increased. So basophilia more than 20%, blast cells between 10 to 19%. And then in some cases, we find that the platelets are markedly increased, more than 10 lakhs. These are all evidences that the patient has gone on to an accelerated phase. This is a bone marrow showing you the accelerated phase with increased number of blast cells. When we do that refined biopsy to confirm that these are blast cells, we can do markers. We can put up CD34, CD117 in case it is a myeloid type of blast crisis. Can we have another type of blast crisis? Yes. At times we have lymphoid blast crisis. We can have megakaryoblastic type of blast crisis. And sometimes we come across even monocytic and rarely promyelocytic type of blast crisis in these cases of CML. Now, this is the accelerated phase. Refined biopsy, what does it show is in the paratrabecular area, there are clusters of blastoid cells confirmed by CD34 and CD117. Sometimes we find that there are small, tiny clusters of 4 to 6 cells which are seen throughout the marrow, and the patient on peripheral smear demonstrates 10 to 19% blast cells. Now, some of these cases of accelerated phase or straight away, now we find that with the imatinib era, the number of accelerated phase cases has decreased. Most of the patients, they go on to blastic phase directly. So when do we see the blastic phase? As per WHO 2017 is that the blast cells either in the peripheral blood or in the bone marrow should be more than 20%. As you can see here, good number of blast cells in the peripheral smear, and then extramedullary accumulation of blasts. Sometimes these patients come to us with myeloid sarcoma or granulocytic sarcoma, which may occur in the skin, which may occur in the breast, periosteum, or sometimes even retrobulbar resulting in proptosis. So there is an extramedullary accumulation of blast cells. But the WHO says that if we find even less than 10% lymphoblasts, because if they are less than 10%, say 8%, 9%, 7%, now these are the cases which are rapidly going on to a blastic phase of lymphoblastic type. So what we should do is that in case we find that these are myeloblasts, then we are aware of the fact that this patient has gone on to blast crisis. Sometimes we find these are CD117 negative, indicating that these are not myeloblasts. So these could be lymphoblasts. So what we should do is that we should put up the markers, and or they should be subjected to flow cytometry or immunohistochemistry to confirm that these are lymphoblast type of blast crisis. Sometimes while examining a peripheral smear, we come across these nuclei, which are bare nuclei, sometimes little bit of cytoplasma is seen. These are the bare nuclei of the megakaryocytes, which come into the peripheral blood. However, in this particular case, we find that not only that bare nucleus, but we are coming across large number of blast cells also. Basophilia is there, another basophilia is there. So probably this patient is in CML blast crisis because of the fact that the number of blast cells is more. As I told you that sometimes these blast cells will show us cytoplasmic budding. Here you find cytoplasmic budding or the platelet budding is seen, and we come across these cases of megakaryoblastic type of blast crisis, which can occur in these cases. This is on bone marrow refined biopsy. You find that the marrow is replaced by sheets of blast cells all over the marrow. and then we can do immunohistochemistry to see whether it is MPO positive or these are lymphoid type of blast crisis. This is a case of blast crisis of lymphoid type. Here we find that the blast cells are smaller, myeloperoxidase stain, positive in other promyelocytes, myelocytes, but the blast cells are negative. And then this is a CD10 positive blast cells, indicating that we are dealing with a lymphoid type of blast crisis. And then in such cases on the bone marrow trephine biopsy, we can put up various markers like CD34, TDT positive, 117 is negative because it is a lymphoid blast crisis. PAX5 and CD10 are indicators of precursor B ALL type of blast crisis in CML. We must keep in mind that all the cases with leukocytosis, all the cases with myeloid precursors in the peripheral blood or bone marrow are not cases of, these are not cases of CML. It could be a reactive neutrophilia also. We have to rule it out. And then there could be some neoplastic conditions like chronic neutrophilic leukemia. It could be atypical CML. It could be a chronic myelomonocytic leukemia. It could be MPN unclassified. Some cases of primary myelofibrosis with leukocytosis. Some cases of polycythemia vera with leukocytosis. They may also give a picture similar to chronic myeloid leukemia. So we have to differentiate from them. Say, for example, chronic neutrophilic leukemia. Now, how do we differentiate CML from chronic neutrophilic leukemia? Because here also we find that the TLC is very high. It is more than 25,000. But what is more important is that the segmented neutrophils are more than 80%. That means the immature cells, myelo, meta, promyelos, those are less than 20% only. So these are, and myeloblasts are rarely observed. Monocyte count is less than 1,000. Bone marrow is hypercellular, but then in this hypercellular, we find that the neutrophil granulocytes are the major cells in this. Myeloblasts are less than 5%. But then we must rule out that this is not a case of CML by doing BCR ABL. And if we feel that it could be PV, ET, or PMF, then we may go ahead and do a JAK2, KLR, or MPL. Then we have to rule out that these are not associated with eosinophilia like PDGFRA, PDGFRB, or FGFR1 positive. And then these cases of neutrophilic leukemia are associated with CSF3R mutation. Now that is the positive in these majority of them, but some cases may not demonstrate, but then we must demonstrate clonality of the myeloid cells by cytogenetic or molecular studies. Now this is on morphology. We find that the TLC is high, and then you find that the granules in this are very prominent and abnormal, like toxic granules. So we should carry out in these cases neutrophilic alkaline phosphatase score, which is very, very high in cases of leukemoid reaction. And what do we find in the bone marrow is that the majority of the cells in the bone marrow trephine biopsy you find are the neutrophils, with of course few myelocytes, metamyelocyte. Major thing is that these cases are BCR ABL negative. So in these cases, we cannot give imatinib. Imatinib is to be given only the cases which are BCR ABL positive. So therefore, since BCR ABL negative, so we have to differentiate these cases from cases of CML. Then we have atypical CML. Now, atypical CML are the cases in which you find, again, there's leukocytosis. Then you find that there are neutrophils, myelocytes, metamyelocytes, band forms, blast cells, promyelocytes. So these counts may nearly be same or less than a case of CML. But what we find is dysgranulopoiesis. Now that is the most important thing in atypical CML. And this dysgranulopoiesis is manifested morphologically, where you find the abnormal shape, metamyelocytes, myelocytes, as well as band forms. However, the blast cells are less than 20%. It is just like in cases of CML. And these cases are also BCR-ABL negative, but they also have spleen. Now, they do not respond to imatinib. Now, these are the cases in which the prognosis is poor, and we have to give hydroxyurea in these cases. Then we have chronic myelomonocytic leukemia. Now, this has been put up in MPN-MDS series, where we find, or the MPN-MDS group of disorders. In this, the monocytes are important because there is a persistent absolute monocytosis, which is more than 1,000. And of course, these do not meet the criteria of CML, PMF, PV, or essential thrombocythemia. The blast cells are less than 20%, including myeloblasts, monoblasts, and promonocytes. And there is a morphologic dysplasia, because this has been placed in MPN-MDS. So these cases do demonstrate dysplasia. And dysplasia is at least in one myeloid lineage. So that means it may be in the myeloid series, maybe in the erythroid series, or maybe in the megakaryocytic series. Now we have WHO classifying them into two types, type 1, type 2, with 2 to 4% blasts, and type 2 with 5 to 19% blasts. Of course, in these cases also, we come across splenomegaly, and there is heterogeneous clinical manifestations, cutaneous lesions, infections, and bleeding. Now, microscopically, what we find is that there is a monocytic proliferation, which is the hallmark by which we can differentiate these cases from CML or from other myeloproliferative disorders. Dysgranulopoiesis or dysmegakaryopoiesis is demonstrable. Moderate reticulin fibrosis is seen in these cases. Now, whenever we have chronic myelomonocytic leukemia, we have to differentiate it from acute monocytic or M5B acute leukemia also. Now, we know that the WHO has given that the promonocytes, as you can see here, promonocytes are to be counted as blast equivalents. Now, what is a promonocyte? Now, as you can see, these are the two are monocytes. These are immature monocytes where you find lobulated nuclei, basophilic or gray-colored cytoplasm. Here again, you find promonocytes are almost similar. What is the difference is that the nuclei are visible in promonocytes. And of course, in monoblasts, you come across very prominent nucleoli in monoblasts. So promonocytes plus monoblasts, if they are more than 20%, because these are blast equivalents, and these, of course, are blasts, and then these are to be taken, if more than 20%, as acute monocytic leukemia. If the addition of the two is less than 20%, then we have to think whether we are dealing with a case of chronic myelomonocytic leukemia. But then what is important is to differentiate promonocytes from the monocytes, because in these cases of CMML, in the peripheral blood and the bone marrow, we come across monocytes, immature monocytes, promonocytes, and monoblasts. So the differentiation of one from the other is the most important thing. Now, this is the peripheral smear of a case of CMML, where you find that there is monocytosis. And here you find there are prominent nucleoli, but lobulated nucleus. Whenever you find a lobulated nucleus, open chromatin like lacy chromatin, basophilic cytoplasm with nucleoli, it is a promonocyte. And if the nucleus is round with nucleoli like any other blast, those are like this one, we label that as blast. So the sum of blast plus promonocytes should be less than 20%. And here you find that the monocytic cells in the bone marrow. If we do non-specific S-trace, it will be positive in all the three. That is, it will be positive in the monocytes, in the immature monocytes, in the promonocytes, as well as in the monoblast non-specific S-trace. The only thing, advantage of NSC is that we can differentiate them from the myeloid cells. This is the bone marrow trephine biopsy. Here you find a population of myeloid cells with neutrophils, metamyelocytes, and then you are also seeing these cells which are monocytoid. They have lobulated nuclei and abundant amount of cytoplasm. So this is a myelomonocytic proliferation in a case of CMML, and the markers do help in that. And this is to show you a picture of a case of M5B acute monocytic leukemia, where you come across blast cells, promonocytes with lobulated nuclei, promonocytes with lobulated nuclei and nucleoli, and then you have the monocyte. Now, all of them are the NSC positive. Then we go on to chronic eosinophilic leukemia. Now, this is a rare myeloproliferative neoplasm in which we find there is an increase in circulating eosinophils and there is a left-shifted granulocytic maturation. There is often hepato and splenomegaly, and there is tissue infiltration. Now, this tissue infiltration by eosinophils and eosinophilic microabscesses are found in various tissues, maybe in the skin, you find in liver and splenomegaly, and even in heart. And sometimes these eosinophilic infiltration affects the heart, resulting in sometimes heart failure as well. Now, some of these cases may transform to acute leukemia as well. But we have to keep in mind that all reactive causes of eosinophilia must be excluded. Also, we have to exclude the myeloid and lymphoid neoplasms, which are associated with PDGFRA, PDGFRB, or FGFR1, or JAK2 fusion mutations. So these are the WHO criteria. We find eosinophilia and does not meet the WHO criteria of any of the myeloproliferative neoplasms or atypical CML or CMML. No PDGFRA, PDGFRB, FGFR1, or PCM1, JAK2. Blasts should be less than 20%. It is a chronic eosinophilic leukemia, so the blasts are less than 20%. And then we have to rule out other disorders in which there is eosinophilia, like M4 with inversion 16, M4 with T1616, or M2 with T821. Those should be excluded. Then we should demonstrate a clonal cytogenetic or molecular abnormality. But keep in mind, first thing is to exclude all possible causes of reactive eosinophilia. Now, this is the bone marrow of a case of chronic eosinophilic leukemia, where you find eosinophils, eosinophilic myelocytes, metamyelocytes, eosinophilic promyelocytes are present. Another important feature is to differentiate it from other eosinophilic disorders is the presence of the blast cells. Now, that is, if we find that the blast cells are prominent, though they are less than 20%, it is highly suggested that we may be dealing with a case of chronic eosinophilic leukemia. This is a bone marrow defined biopsy, where you find there is an occasional blast cell, and you are also seeing this large number of eosinophils and eosinophilic myelomata along with myeloid proliferation. So this is eosinophilia marrow, as you can see here. And then you are finding that there are blast cells are present in between. Similarly here, you find that the blast cells with prominent nucleoli and there is eosinophilia. Now, cardiac fibrosis results because of the infiltration by eosinophils into the myocardium. These cases of chronic eosinophilic leukemia in later stages undergo fibrosis. There is increased reticulin. As they undergo reticulin deposition, fibrosis, and you find that the blast cell starts increasing. And this increase in blast cells, usually the type of acute leukemia which develops is AML type. So CEL, with the presence of fibrosis, one must look for blast cells, carry out CD34, CD117 to know whether this patient is going on to blast crisis or not. But keep in mind the differential diagnosis like reactive eosinophilia, which are much more common in parasitic infections, in allergies, and pulmonary and skin diseases. And of course, some of the neoplastic conditions like T-cell lymphoma with eosinophilia, Hodgkin's lymphoma may be associated with eosinophilia, and lymphoblastic leukemia. And finally, idiopathic HES or hyper-eosinophilic syndrome. Now, what is this idiopathic hyper-eosinophilic syndrome is? Here also we find there is eosinophilia. Count is more than 1500, persisting for more than 6 months. Again, we have to exclude all causes of reactive eosinophilia. AML, MPN, MDS, and all these systemic mastocytosis must be excluded. And we find here also that more than two organ systems are involved, maybe bone marrow with liver, bone marrow with the lymph nodes or splenic, and regular monitoring is essential. So what do we find here? The WHO has given the criteria for its diagnosis is that eosinophil count exclusion is more important than the eosinophil count of 1500. Here exclude all the myeloproliferative disorders and exclude even the aberrant T cell population or T cell lymphomas. Now this is what we come across in hyper eosinophilic syndrome. Here we find peripheral blood, which is showing us eosinophilia, but then we find vacuoles in these cytoplasm. Now these vacuoles means that the degranulation of these eosinophils has occurred. And in the bone marrow, what we come across is there is eosinophilia, eosinophilic myelomata, and then you come across cells like this or cells like this, in which you find that there are both eosinophilic and basophilic granulation. Now that is a characteristic feature of hyper eosinophilic syndrome. Of course, one can come across in various other dysplastic conditions also, but in this condition of hyper eosinophilic syndrome, this is very important to distinguish it from reactive eosinophilia. So the take home message is that for diagnosis of CML, BCR-ABL is essential. Nowadays, we must do BCR-ABL before we label a patient as a case of CML. And as we make the diagnosis of CML, we should keep in mind that the basophilia and eosinophilia are integral part of CML diagnosis. And whenever we find a patient is non-responsive to treatment, we should keep in mind that this patient is going either into accelerated phase or blastic phase. And whenever we are doing a bone marrow refined biopsy and you find a granulocytic proliferation with dwarf megakaryocytes, this morphology is highly suggestive of CML. As the marrow fibrosis occurs, as the megakaryocytes proliferate, we know that this patient is going into an advanced phase of CML. Keep in mind that the blastic phase could be myeloid or it could be even 15 to 20% cases could be of lymphoblastic. Few cases could be of M7 type of blast crisis as well. As far as the eosinophilic disorders and chronic eosinophilic leukemia is concerned, we must investigate each and every case of eosinophilia before he goes on to cardiac fibrosis to rule out whether we are dealing with a reactive eosinophilia, hyper eosinophilic syndrome, or chronic eosinophilic leukemia. The next webinar is on, again, myeloproliferative neoplasms. It will be taken by Dr. Priya Murthy, and she will cover the BCR-ABL negative, that is polycythemia vera, essential thrombocythemia, PMF, and how to differentiate one from the other and arrive at a diagnosis. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that exhaustive presentation on chronic myeloid leukemia and all the other related disorders. It is indeed, every time we listen to you, we learn something more. Thank you so much. We have a few questions, which I'll just read out for you, sir.
Yes.
Deepa S. wants to know, what are the IHC markers for lymphoblasts?
See, for lymphoblasts, usually the type of blast crisis is B cell type. And for the B cell type, we must do PAX5, CD10, CD20, TDT, and of course CD34. These are the minimal markers. Sometimes we also carry out CD79A in these cases.
So Ifat Jamal wants to know, what is a NAP score in CNL?
In chronic neutrophilic leukemia, it is usually normal or slightly increased. Sometimes few cases may show slight decrease also. So it is usually anything between 20 to 60 is the usual score in cases of chronic neutrophilic leukemia.
Praveen Kumar wants to know how to differentiate between a chronic neutrophilic leukemia from reactive neutrophilia, and what is the clue to suspect neutrophilic leukemia?
See, if the patient has got splenic enlargement along with persistent neutrophilia, because the granules in both are similar, they look like toxic granules. Number one is that on morphology, it may appear like as if both are similar, because even in neutrophilic leukocytosis, there is slight shift to the left and few myelocytes and metamyelocytes are seen. It may be difficult, but the spleen is a clue which is very, very positive in cases of chronic neutrophilic leukemia.
So there's a question, what is the incidence of CML? Because there's somebody seen one in the second decade. What is the normal age group do we see CML in?
Yes. Today only we have reported CML in an 11-year-old girl. See, we have seen cases of CML from 6 years of age onwards. Though in children it is uncommon, but it is not rare. So we do come across children with typical CML and classical CML in which BCR-ABL is positive. So what we have to do is carry out BCR-ABL. Only then imatinib therapy may be given in these cases.
I think those are the questions.
Right.
Somebody wants to know if there's a diluted aspirate is suitable for flow cytometry.
No, a diluted bone marrow aspirate, whether for acute leukemia or for a blast crisis, is not suitable. Because in CML blast crisis, in any case, some blast cells are present, which are up to 5%. So that will not help us in making the diagnosis. Even for acute leukemia, we find that the diluted marrow, since there are no blast cells or very, very few blast cells, it does not help in making the diagnosis, and on the basis of that, we cannot give the treatment.
Somebody wants to know, please describe some specific granulopoiesis features in CMML.
In CMML, as the very name indicates, there is a chronic myelomonocytic leukemia. So there is proliferation of both monocytic as well as myeloid series. Monocytes, I have shown you that these are the various types of monocytes we come across. As far as the dysplasia is concerned in the myeloid series, we find that there are irregularities of the nuclear margin. The nuclear shape is distorted. You find there is a hypogranularity in some of the neutrophils. Even you find that the myelos and metas may be hypogranular in these cases, and the nuclear margins or the nuclear outlines are distorted. So therefore, on the basis of those, we can make a diagnosis of dysmyelopoiesis along with monocytosis, and that is a feature of CMML.
Radhika Narayan wants to know how to deal with cases of thrombocytosis with negative BCR-ABL and negative JAK2 MPL and CALR.
See, these are triple negative cases of thrombocytosis, and about 10% of the cases of myeloproliferative neoplasms are triple negative. But these are the cases which also show one other mutation. Usually it may be IDH1, IDH2, it may be ASXL1. Now these are some of the mutations, which are the minor mutations that may be present in these cases. So in case we find that the three driver mutations are negative in these cases, we should carry out a set of these 10 mutations, which are usually seen in triple negative cases. So if once that is carried out, then we know that it is a clonal, again, disorder, or it is a clonal proliferation, and then we can start the treatment for such cases.
Sir, in this case, we also need to rule out reactive thrombocytosis.
Sure. Yes. I think that is the major thing, because all cases of thrombocytosis, first thing, because thrombocytosis is very, very common. Secondary or reactive thrombocytosis is very, very common. So that should be ruled out first, whether it is post-trauma, whether it is post-surgery, whether it is a post-pregnancy. In all these conditions, we come, even exercise can lead to thrombocytosis. So we must rule out reactive thrombocytosis first, before we start thinking on the lines of a myeloproliferative disorder, unless spleen is palpable. Because if spleen is palpable and we find some dysmorphia in the platelets, suggestive of that we are dealing with a myeloproliferative neoplasm.
Sir, somebody wants to know how to distinguish dysplastic neutrophil in CMML from promonocytes, as a promonocyte is a blast equivalent.
Promonocyte is a blast equivalent, but then it must demonstrate nucleoli. We will label it as promonocyte only if nucleoli are present. Dysplastic neutrophil will never show us a nucleoli. That is how we distinguish, because sometimes we do come across neutrophils with folded and lobated nuclei, but they will not show us any nucleoli. That is a main difference between promonocyte and a dysplastic neutrophil.
So, is there a role of CD34 IHC in CML?
CD34 IHC has a role if we are suspecting accelerated phase or blastic phase, because the commonest type of accelerated phase and the blastic phase is a myeloid type. And the myeloid type of blast crises are demonstrable more with CD117 than with CD34. It is well known that somehow in CML blast cells, they demonstrate CD117 positivity more than CD34 positivity. And hence, single marker should never be employed to diagnose a particular case as accelerated phase or a blast crisis.
Deepa wants to know how to differentiate a hypolobated megakaryocyte from a dwarf megakaryocyte.
Dwarf megakaryocyte is also smaller. Hypolobated means that the nucleus is round to oval and it is not showing any lobation, which can happen even in 5q deletion. In 5q deletion, we come across megakaryocytes which are normal sized, but they are hypolobated or unlobated. While the dwarf megakaryocyte is smaller and is hypolobated, it may show one lobulation at the maximum, but by and large, it also has an oval nucleus. So that is the difference between a hypolobated and a dwarf megakaryocyte. Hypolobated just means hypolobation, which may be of normal size, as in 5q deletion. But the dwarf means smaller. So the dwarf is smaller with a hypolobated nucleus. That is in CML.
So I think we come to the end of the question answers. So thank you so much for answering all the questions. And thank you very much for the brilliant talk. So we come to the end of this session.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Priya and Mr. Amir. Thank you so much.